it's like so upbeat and lively. It's great, huh? Seriously. I just love that kind of rhythm there. Makes you move for the Lord. Amen. Way to get up with the get down there, Victoria. Let's open our Bibles to Galatians 6, verses 11 to 18. We are finishing Galatians today. Wow. It's been quite a while we've been going through Galatians. As I said, for the next few weeks, we're going to do topical sermons, and we're going to be on the fruits of the Spirit, and then we're going to get back into expository sermons in Ephesians. So this is exciting. I don't know. People have different preferences. Some people like expository, some people like topical. I like to finish a book, do a few topicals, and then come back to expository preaching. So I hope that works for everybody. Today we're doing expository preaching, where we break down verse by verse. So we're going to start verse 6:11. See with what large letters I am writing to you with my own hand. Of course, this is Paul speaking. It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh who would force you to be circumcised, and only in order that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. For even those who are circumcised do not themselves keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised that they may boast in the flesh, in your flesh, I'm sorry. But far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision counts for anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. And as for all who walk by this rule, peace and mercy be upon them and upon the Israel of God. From now on, let no one cause me trouble, for I bear on my own body the marks of Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you, with your spirit, brothers. Amen. This benediction, this final warning, this final close from Paul has a lot of meat in it. As we've been studying through Galatians, Galatians is pretty heavy. In fact, Galatians is the primer for Romans, which, if you've read Romans, is Paul's powerhouse, is legal powerhouse to the gospel and how we are saved. And it's what we use when we talk to people to get them to understand how they can be saved, the Romans road. So when you read Galatians, keep that in mind. It's kind of a primer there for what Paul wants to finally prove out in a legal fashion in Romans. He starts off by saying, this is in my own hand. He uses a secretary or an amanuensis, which means he has somebody use the right form. Now, a lot of times we don't know why, but a lot of people believe the thorn in Paul's side was his eyesight. He had difficulty, so he would dictate and somebody would write for him. But we have examples in Corinthians, Colossians, and Thessalonians, where he says, this is my own hand. He wants to make sure that people know I am behind this letter. Because we do know there were some false letters that were put out there, and they were said to be of Paul, but they were not. So first off, he just wants to say that I have written you. And also think of it this way, in large letters, it's kind of like when you do all caps, and you're yelling. You're like, pay attention. Kind of like if you're in Germany, Achtung, this is important for you to listen to. So he wants to make sure that they're paying attention. This was from me, and this final postscript, this benediction, I need you to pay attention. It always reminds me of John Hancock writing it big so King George can say, ah, you know, this person really wants me to see his name. Paul really wants to say, this is from me. So let's go to verse 12. It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh who would force you to be circumcised, and only in order that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. 13. For even those who are circumcised do not themselves keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised so that they may boast in the flesh. These are different kinds of boasts we're going to discuss here, boasting in the flesh and boasting in the cross of Christ. It starts with this boasting in the flesh. You got to think, this whole build-up to Galatians was about these Judaizers. And we're not going to hear this name for a little while, but we've heard it through all of Galatians. And they kept saying, you know what? I know that you accept Jesus Christ, but you are not quite saved. unless you do these things under the law, you're just not them. But Paul goes further in his admonition. Remember in Galatians 1:8, starting in verse 8, he says, even if someone teaches you a different gospel, let them be accursed. He's kind of bringing that forward here. These people are teaching you a gospel of works, and it will damn you. And they're only doing it to boast in their own flesh. They're also doing it to not be persecuted. I was watching a documentary. And a lot of times we don't realize that the persecution that these people were going through during this period of time, the Romans were hunting them down. But Judaism was an acceptable religion in the Roman world. So a lot of them thought, you know what? I don't want to fully be a Christian, because if I can tie myself to Judaism, I can say, no, I'm Jewish, and that is an acceptable religion. Whereas Christianity was considered a sect or a cult, and they were to be hunted down and persecuted and imprisoned and killed. So a lot of them thought, hey, you know, not only do we've lived our life with meritorious works, so you know, you gotta do that, but secondly, let's not go all the way. Let's not take it to that extreme, because you know, then we might be persecuted. Nobody wants that. Does God really want you to take it all the way so it's just by faith, just through Jesus Christ? So a lot of them were trying to combine the two and say, you know, we can meld these together and it'll work. And they were trying to avoid that persecution. And at the same time, many of them were saying, you know what? I want to boast in this. This church was all messed up. You know, we went to that Christian church in Galatia that Paul established. You know, okay, I've heard some good things about Paul, but they were messed up. And the men were uncircumcised. The women weren't dressing properly according to the law. And we had to go and fix them. We had a job to do. And look at us. We saved that church. We got them back under the yoke of the law like they should be. That's what they were saying. They were going around boasting about it. Look at us. Look what we've done. We saved Christian churches by bringing them back under Judaism. We brought them back under the law. And that's what they were boasting about. I'm going to bring something up here I talked about in Bible study. A lot of people don't know. These men were boasting about the flesh. It says they were boasting in your flesh. I'm talking about the men who were being circumcised. You can take a reference back to David. In 1 Samuel, King Saul had reneged on his offer for the first daughter and had married the first daughter off to someone else after David had killed Goliath. And he said, well, what, you want my second daughter, Michal. Michal had fallen in love with him. And Saul didn't like David very much. This was right after they were coming back from battle, and all these people were singing a song. And the song went, Saul has killed his thousands, and David has killed his tens of thousands. And Saul was a jealous man anyway. He was like, oh, I don't like this. I want to get rid of David. How can I get David killed? He said, okay. You want Michal? You want her? I want 100 foreskins from the Philistines. I'll just read it. It says, David was delighted to accept this offer from Saul. Before the time limit expired, he even set a time limit. And his men went out and killed not 100, but 200 Philistines. Then David fulfilled the king's requirements by presenting all of their foreskins to him. So Saul gave his daughter Michal to David to be his wife. Kind of hard for us to get our head around to slaughter these men. He didn't even do 100. That was the requirement. He killed 200 to make a point. Because Saul wanted the Philistines to kill David. And David, who was blessed by God, did twice what he was required, but he brought those forces. So it's kind of this mentality of the Jews. Look, these pagans, we can conquer them. New Christians, many of them were Gentiles. These pagan people, we need to take their foreskins. And this was an example. And as David rightfully could boast, these people in Galatia could not rightfully, it was wrong for them to boast it. Because they, as Paul says, were not living it themselves. They were presenting it and boasting it, but it wasn't what they believed in them. And Paul is attacking them. Galatians 6:13 says, "For neither they themselves who are circumcised keep the law." So he set this up, and he says, those men who are trying to get you to become circumcised and go back under the law are like the Pharisees. They do not keep the law themselves. And you are falling for it. You had freedom in Christ and you're putting yourself back under the law. And they say, that they may glory in your flesh, which is what we just talked about. The flesh affords nothing. Jeremiah tells us the heart is desperately wicked. The world thinks I can work my way to God. I can clean myself up enough to maybe come to church one day. But before that, you know, if I go there, God might strike me down for stepping onto his holy ground. So I'll just get myself right before God before I go and accept that gift he has to offer me. Well, on the other hand, these people thought, I'll get these people to acquiesce to what our demands are, and then we will feel accepted before God for doing this. My uncle sent me a joke. And it reminded me of this today. Because in a sense, we have a movement, the LGBT movement, who's trying to force these doctrines upon everybody so that they can feel that they're accepted. And if everyone accepts them, they must be accepted. Kind of the same idea. Listen, we just want everybody to acquiesce to us. Then even though we're not keeping the law, we know that we've done our part. And everybody has to conform to our thoughts. Therefore, it can be accepted. But on a lighter note, he sent me a comment and said, on women's marches, if the liberals don't believe in biological gender, then why do they march for women's rights? Which made me think of this, and it's true. If we distort the truth, if we distort the simplicity of what God has offered, we will try and make people conform to what we believe so that we can feel accepted. Because we all know that there's this hole in our heart. We all know that we want to be right before God, so we think we have to do it. And if we know our conscience is telling us we're wrong, we think as humans without God, we can make other people agree with us. Therefore, we must be okay in this thinking. If everybody else is in agreement, it must be okay. And I will force my view on everybody until they say it's okay so I can sleep at night. And that's what they are doing. That's what we see today in the world. Let's take this whatever aberrant behavior the media throws at us and make it normal. I've said this before when I was driving through Hollywood and I saw the first time I saw that sign that said, have an affair. And it was only for married people. It was a website to connect married people with other married people. And it's so aberrant. It's so sinful. And they were trying to make it normative. And it's just like the Holy Spirit is just like, oh, you feel that in your heart. The world is trying to make this sin normal. Because they know. Everyone knows they will stand before them. And it's people think if I stand before God and everyone else agreed, they can say, well, look at everyone else. They agreed with me. They acquiesced to my demand. That's how heavy this postscript is in our life today. It wasn't just for the Galatians. It's for all of us. Seeing these people trying to get us to conform and take away from the simplicity of the gospel. I was at Bible study this morning, and I like to take what we're teaching and break it down in a little bit different way so people can get more from the study. And we were talking about the fact that Paul is saying, I preach nothing but the cross of Christ. Nothing but the cross of Christ. The cross of Christ in the first century, to most people, was distant. I just watched a documentary on James's church in Jerusalem, and they were showing how they would mark, and it would be a menorah with the Star of David and a fish on the bottom. And in this documentary, they were going through Italy, and they were going through Jerusalem and other parts, and they were showing the symbols of the first and second century churches, and they said, what seems absent? What is absent is the cross. And it's not because they didn't love the cross. It's not because they didn't want everyone to know what Jesus had done. It's because it was so real. In these churches, they had escape hatches so the Romans wouldn't catch them. And if they caught them, many of them went to the cross. Their family and their friends were being tortured and crucified. Think about your mother and your brother and your sister have been on the cross, and you say, you know, that's what I'm going to put on my neck. Bring it forward to today. When the Antichrist comes, he's going to be chopping off heads. Brothers and sisters in Christ and family members, it's like saying, I'm going to put the guillotine right here. Wear it around my neck. Or an electric chair, some other form of absolute torture. Now the cross is different because it shows us not only our sin, but it shows us our redemption. The cross is the greatest example of God's absolute justice, absolute righteousness, and his unbelievably perfect mercy. And when I was teaching this morning, I brought up something a lot of people don't know. We have a typological example in the Old Testament. I actually had to look up the reference. And in Numbers 21, when the Israelites were in the desert, they were mad at God and mad at Moses, and they were sinning. God was fed up with them again. And it says, they traveled from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom. But the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord, in his anger, sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, we sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us. So Moses prayed for the people. I want you to think about this for a second. The people are grumbling. God has brought them out of Egypt, but all they can do is complain constantly. Take us back. They had leeks and onions and things. All we have now is this angel food. Moses, what have you done? God, what have you done? And they're mad and they're angry. They're not seeing the glory of God who is with them every day in the cloud and the fire. And God is mad. And they're being sinful. And he sends the picture of sin, the serpent among them. And they cry out, redeem us! Save us! They're being bitten by these snakes and dying left and right. And it says, the Lord said to Moses, make a snake and put it on a pole, and anyone who is bitten can look at it and live. So Moses made a bronze snake and put it on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, they lived. It's a little hard to get around. What was God teaching? What is this? The simplicity of the gospel is the cross. The simplicity here was, do you trust that what God has said to do in this example of sin that is killing you? He said he lifted up the example of the sin that you have, and if you look upon it and trust God, he will save you. And yet, many of them said, no, I won't trust what God has said, and the symbol he has said will save me. Just like today when you say to someone, Christ became our sin on the cross. Look upon it, and you will be saved. Trust in it in your heart. And what do they say? It's too easy. It's got to be harder. I got to work for it. And I don't want that. I don't believe in propitiatory sin. I don't believe that God can take it from me. And Paul says, look to the cross. These first century believers, the cross was frightening to them. And Paul says, no, the cross, the cross, the cross. We know we're being persecuted. We know when we see the cross, it reminds us of those we've lost. But it is the cross where our sins were dealt with. It is the cross where we were redeemed. It is on the cross that we have eternal life through Jesus Christ. It is the cross, it is the cross, it is the cross. We go to the store now, we buy a cross, we really don't think of the magnitude of living through what this first and second century church lived through in the persecution that was upon them. In Hebrews it says, think of the hostility Christ endured for sinful people. Then you won't become weary and give up. After all, you have not yet given your lives in your struggle against sin. We live our lives in a struggle against sin. Even as new creatures, as new creations. And we see a world that boasts in the flesh. I'm better than you. I can make it before God on my own merits. You think you can just receive it. Everything they do, Matthew said, in Matthew it says, they do for show, talking about the Pharisees. On their arms they wear extra wide prayer boxes with scripture verses inside, and they wear robes with extra long tassels. Kind of like wearing more jewelry than you need. Oh, I want my tassels longer than their tassels. I want my robe more flowing and more colorful. I want more and more so God can see how holy I am. Look. And they love to sit at the head table, the banquets, and the seats of honor in the synagogues. They love to receive respectful greetings as they walk in the marketplace and to be called rabbi. When Christians walk through the streets, they're afraid they're going to be stoned or beaten or turned into the soldier. They don't walk around with a big cross saying, look at me, I believe Jesus Christ. They hid in the shadows, but they love the Lord. And many of them died. Many, 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 many died when they did stand up. Because of the simplicity of the gospel, it is the antithesis to human pride. Human pride says, no! It's all about me! I want to be better than everyone else because of me. No one comes to the cross in pride. The only way to come to Jesus is in absolute humility. Realizing that he was lifted up so that the sin that has cursed you, the poison that is in your veins and damning you, dead men and women walking every day, can be freed from that and given eternal life. We boast in nothing but the cross. We boast in nothing but the cross. We boast in nothing but the cross. Not in ourselves. Not in our accomplishments, because anything we ever accomplish is a gift from God and a blessing from Him. And if He takes it away, He's got a reason. And if He gives it, He has a reason. It's the cross of Christ. Absolute justice. Pure, righteous justice. And absolute, glorious mercy. Mercy for a bunch of sinners who are angry at God. And He said, I love you. You know, when I think of relationships and marriage, I'm not a good husband because I'm a good husband. The things I do that are good is because Christ lives in me. My wife is not a good wife because she's a good wife. She's a good wife because Christ lives in me. We're good brothers and sisters in fellowship because Christ lives in us, not because of our own merits we would be good. I know what it's like to be selfish. I'm good at it. I'm good at pride, too. When they start to come up again, look to the cross. When they start to haunt you and taunt you and whisper in your ear, look to the cross. Galatians 5:16 says, but I say, if you walk in the Spirit, you will not gratify the sins of the flesh. There's a condition. If you walk in this spirit, then you will not gratify the sin of the flesh. If then, a condition for all of us to walk circumspectly before our God. Galatians 6:15, for neither circumcision counts for anything nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. It always takes you back to 2 Corinthians. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. There's a headstone, a famous one. It says, this old man died 7 years ago. He'd walked with the Lord for 7 years. He was made new. He wanted everyone to know, I was made new 7 years ago, and yet I wasn't old. Why do we write down the day we were baptized or the day we accepted Christ in our lives? Because we are now new. We are not old. We are a new creation. This new creation is not an outward show. It's not being boastful. Look, God forgave me. Huh? Look at you guys. Look at me. Huh? It's not that. If it's that, then there's something wrong. To have a heart for Christ, to realize the necessity for the cross. It's to realize the necessity that Jesus Christ took and did what you could never give or handle on your own. He took your sin as a gift for your redemption. It's always important for us to remember that sin necessitates punishment. It must be righteously punished because God is righteous. God does not sweep sin under the rug. But because of Jesus Christ, He can say, He has taken your sin. I will remember it no more. As far as the east is to the west, it is gone. I have forgotten it. If nothing else, that should make our hearts sing. We are all sinners. We're just the people. Why? Because of the cross. The cross of Christ. We're going to read 14 to 18. But God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them, and mercy upon the Israel of God. By the way, we are all the Israel of God. Those who have Jesus in their heart. The Redeemer in the Old Testament, our Savior in the New Testament. That is the Israel of God. Spiritual Israel. It goes on, from now on, let no one trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. Brethren, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you in spirit. Amen. 2 Corinthians says, are they servants of Christ? I know I sound like a madman. But I have served him far more. I have worked harder, been put in prison more often, been whipped times without number, faced death again and again. 5 different times the Jewish leaders gave me 39 lashes. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. And 1 I spent a whole night and a day adrift at sea. Paul was saying, these marks I bear. Look at me, covered in scars. He says, I bear them for Christ. Your circumcision doesn't do a darn thing for you. If you are not a new creation in Christ, you are not a child of God. And being a child of God might mean, most likely will mean, trials and scars. Count it all joy, brethren, when you face trials and tribulations. Paul could boast on the scars he had for Christ. If something he could boast on, it was that he was serving his Lord, the only, our Savior, our Redeemer. It's a daily, lifelong struggle, joy, maturing, growing, understanding what we believe, why we believe it, sharing the gospel every opportunity we have. Do you think Paul didn't share the gospel when they were picking up stones? Of course he did. We have plenty of examples. He would preach in Marseille, the Areopagus, and very few people would come afterwards and have questions. Why? Because when he mentioned the cross of Christ, people would say, oh, the cross, oh, that's filthy. And then he would say, the resurrection, that's it. But our whole faith is based on the perfect sinless life, Jesus Christ, him on the cross, and his resurrection. The simplicity of the gospel is right there. And when we share it, people say it's too simple. Like in the world it is, whatever, I just have to believe that will save me, all I have to do is look at it. No, I'd rather die. Really? I just have to trust in Jesus and believe that he took my sins and that he was God and he rose. Pretty simple if you break it down. Very, very hard for a prideful heart. When Paul finishes this, after basically making sure in a very strong worded letter that they needed to know exactly who they were in Christ and how they needed to preach Jesus, and the way all of us should,
by saying, brethren, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you and with your spirit. Even though he is so strong with his words, he ends by saying, you are my brothers and sisters in Christ, and I love you. I love you with a heart of Christ. But don't be fooled. Don't fall into sin. Don't fall into believing what these Judaizers and these false prophets teach you. It's never us. It's only Christ. And because it's only Christ, it's only because of the cross. God nailed our sins to the cross. And Jesus wasn't held up there. When you read this at home in your studies, when you study Galatians, and I recommend you do, break it down. Really see what Paul is saying. Develop a bit of the historical context, and you can more deeply understand how frightening and difficult this was for these believers. We really do live relatively easily and what we can say and do here. That's not going to last. Take advantage of it. The persecution is real. And when that happens, those scars won't just be on the inside. They're going to be on the outside. But we will stand and we will serve. Thank you for your word, the power of your word, which is the power unto salvation for all who believe. And we believe that it is the power unto salvation through the blood-stained cross. God, let this fill our hearts and our understandings to the depth that it gives us the strength to endure any hardship that is before us, because we understand what has been done to set us free. We honor you and we praise you.